calls himself a leader, says they're going to put politics aside and put the people first. People are in desperate need of support right now and playing political games at this moment in these crisis situations. These are the height of emergency situations. It's just utterly irresponsible, and it's selfish, and it's about political gamemanship. What's your response?
Well, I think she should look in the mirror. We've been on an emergency footing for 2 weeks straight, round the clock, 24/7. We've been working, my office, our Division of Emergency Management, helping people prepare for Hurricane Helene, helping effectuate rescues of people after Hurricane Helene, helping people pick up the pieces of their lives after Helene, and then have to also turn around and prepare for major impacts and maybe even more impacts from Hurricane Milton, be able to have rescue personnel ready to help people, and then, of course, help with the power restoration, all these things to do. So that's been my sole focus. My focus has not been on dealing with Kamala Harris. I saw the news report. I didn't know she tried to contact me. But I'd also say it's not about you, Kamala. Right. It's about the people of Florida. My focus is exactly where it should be. And I can tell you this. I've worked on these hurricanes under both President Trump and President Biden. Neither of them ever tried to politicize it. She has never called on any of the storms we've had since she's been vice president until apparently now. Why all of a sudden is she trying to parachute in and inject herself when she's never shown any interest in the past? We know it's because of politics. We know it's because of her campaign. I have zero time to entertain these political games. We're going to continue to do what we need to do to prepare and respond to what may be one of the most damaging storms in the history of the United States. So she says focusing on protecting your people is selfish. I think she ought to look in the mirror.
Well, and that's the big soundbite right there. So that's and that's the point right there, is that she had, I mean, how many, this is the first time that she has ever called in. Or demanded. I mean, I don't even know if she actually called him. He said, and I wrote about this on Substack. This is why you should be a subscriber, because if you're not, you didn't get any of this. You didn't know any of this. If she called him, who did she call? Because he said, well, she didn't call my office. I don't know who she called. He had already gotten a call from Joe Biden. By the way, Joe Biden had a press conference just a little bit earlier, and he was asked about this. So this is the second time that he said anything about this, because he tweeted about this earlier this morning. And I noted it over at on X. I noted it over on X. He had said something about it this morning, and saying that he had already been in contact with the Florida governor and that they had everything that they needed. And I thought that was very interesting, because, I mean, he just sort of threw her under the bus right there. But Kamala Harris, she's the vice president. The vice president is not involved in this process. He had already spoken to the White House. He had already spoken to the president of the United States. Kamala Harris goes out there and demands to have a phone call with DeSantis for some reason, so she can say, she can pretend that she's an adjacent commander in chief. He's in the middle of prepping for the hurricane of a century. And this... the hurricane of a century. This thing is already a Cat 5. They say it's actually going to be bigger when it hits land, and it's expected to make land at some point tomorrow than it is right now. And he's also dealing with Helene recovery. She's stamping her feet, and she's having a tantrum. She spent all day, her people spent all yesterday evening running to the press, complaining about this, that over her failed campaign stunt. I can't imagine an optic any worse than what I just saw with Kamala Harris. Welcome to the program. Dana Loesch with you. Good to be with you. And this is one of our, I mean, the hurricane is really, this is the top story. But the crazy thing is that we're having to deal with Kamala Harris, the vice president of the United States and the Democrat presidential nominee, throwing a fit because the Florida governor took Biden's call and not hers. And this is on the heels of her disastrous 60 Minutes interview. There are more cuts coming out from that. If you thought that what we played for you yesterday was a one-off, Katie, bar the door, because it's not. And then Bill Whitaker's out there just murdering people. The Democrat ticket. I mean, it's unbelievable. We're going to get into all of that. So welcome, Channel 347 DirecTV, also X and Rumble, where the discussion happens. So this, this all happened yesterday. And I first noticed it. I started seeing these headlines. I was in my office and I'm doing prep and I'm looking and I'm seeing these headlines and I'm seeing that Kamala Harris, her campaign has been going and complaining to the press because they're unhappy with that DeSantis ignored her phone call. That's the way it was. Refuses to take call, refuses to answer. DeSantis ignores Harris. Now, the way that they made it sound is that Ron DeSantis is just politicizing this and he is ignoring an offer of help from the vice president of the United States. But that's not the case at all, as you heard from the soundbite that we played. Furthermore, it wasn't just as Harris started having her people go out and whine to the press about it. Then she also said something about it as well. She was, this is audio soundbite 6. She was asked about this because she's been jetting around doing her media blitz, which that's a whole other subject we have to discuss. But this is audio soundbite 6. And the media is more than happy to go along with it. Listen.
Governor DeSantis, NBC is reporting Governor DeSantis is ignoring your calls on hurricanes, resources, and help. How does that hurt the situation here?
You know, moments of crisis, if nothing else, should really be the moment that anyone who calls themselves a leader says they're going to put politics aside and put the people first. People are in desperate need of support right now. And playing political games at this moment in these crisis situations, these are the height of emergency situations, is just utterly irresponsible, and it is selfish, and it is about political gamesmanship instead of doing the job that you took an oath to do, which is to put the people first.
This is absolutely appalling that she's doing this, this optic. Vice presidents have never had a role in this process. And again, Biden has already talked with DeSantis. Both of them confirmed it. Biden tweeted, let me pull this up because this is just on my timeline. Biden tweeted just a little earlier, quote, tonight, he spoke with me yesterday. Tonight, I spoke with Florida Governor DeSantis and Tampa Mayor Castor for first-hand reports on Hurricane Helene recovery and preparation for Milton. My administration is ready to support both leaders and the people of Florida with any further resources they need. He went further with that, saying that he also spoke with National Weather Service, etc. If we have this audio, because this was just a little bit ago, he gave a press conference just a little bit, and he was asked about whether or not he'd been in touch with the Florida governor. He reiterated in his press conference just a little bit earlier that he had been in contact with the Florida governor, kind of repeated what he said yesterday. If we have that, let me know. Kind of repeated what he had said yesterday evening about it. And this was the press conference that he had. He was in his, you know, big O situation room. And this is, I think, some of it. Listen.
Those who do it to try to damage.
That's not the administration. That's not the cut. So what? That's not the cut. So so he had said he had spoken with Florida Governor DeSantis, and then he was asked something separate about North Carolina, which is what he was responding to. So we've got, you know, the president of the United States who is saying that he's, you know, in touch with the Florida governor. The vice president has never had a role in this. Even with Trump, Pence didn't even have a role with this. Cheney didn't have a role with this. Biden, when he was vice president, didn't have a role with this. It's something that the president of the United States, I mean, I can't even believe we have to sit here and explain this to these media people. He's in the middle of prepping for a damn Cat 5 hurricane after going through recovery efforts for Hurricane Helene. All right. Big issue. And so she decides she needs some of that shine. How can she not get cut out 4 weeks before the election and still maintain this position, of like authority or power, still maintain this somehow? How can she do that? Well, she's going to insert herself into this whole process. And that's exactly what she's done. And so now she comes out and says that, well, you know, he's ignoring me. And did you hear how she sounded like she was having a tantrum on the tarmac when she was talking to the press? She sounded like she was having a tantrum. Like, how dare he ignore me? She didn't say anything about, you know what, he's doing the best he can, or that he's, he's in the middle of, you know, hurricane prep. She could have taken, if she was a gracious person, she would have taken the question from that journalist, because that was a setup, by the way. She would have taken that question from that friendly journalist/activist and would have said, you know, Florida is preparing for Category 5 We are here to assist. She could have taken the position of power by appearing generous and accommodating, and instead she decided to do this, diminish herself and throw a tantrum on the tarmac while insisting that she needs to be catered to, because she needs to be able to issue something within her campaign that she's a part of this whole process and that she's there to help. I've never seen a woman who is more unfit to be a leader in my ever-loving life than Kamala Harris. She has no political radar, no political acumen. She can't think quick on her feet. It's embarrassing as a woman that this is what women have to offer for the ticket to run for the White House. It's embarrassing. I mean, don't sit here and talk about how you're an empowered woman when you devolve into a MITOL fit on the tarmac of an airport. We got more on this, but this pisses me off. I've got a lot of friends and family. We have tons of listeners in Florida that are bracing for the worst right now. And her first reaction, I kid you not, this is not hyperbole. Her first reaction wasn't, how can she help those people? It was to bash DeSantis for doing the job that she can't do. Unreal. Now, if you thought that was bad, this comes on the heels of her disastrous 60 Minutes interview. Oh, the cuts keep coming. And it wasn't just her. It was also Tim Walz. Wait until you hear Bill Whitaker take them to the woodshed again, because these cuts just keep on coming. So Kamala Harris, you know, I guess this is part of her amp up. She's doing this crazy, it looks desperate and it looks last minute and contrived and sloppy, because now she's doing Howard Stern. All the Zoomers just discovered that boomer, by the way, because they realized he did a whole skit with Ted Danson and blackface. And now they're all freaking out about it, you know. And then after she did that Daddy Issues podcast, now she's doing Stern. She's going on Colbert. She was on The View today, that she taped for The View today. So she's doing all these hits. She's doing a media blitz. And then a Cat 5 is barreling towards Florida. The optics of this, it is one of the worst run campaigns I've ever seen. I'm saying this compared to Hillary Clinton, too. Can't even believe I've ever would find anybody to say that about, but there we are. So we got a lot of stuff to hit today, because we're going to get into that. We've got all the latest with the hurricane as well. We got a lot of election. I mean, everything is going to be a lot of hurricane, and then also a tale of two responses with private and public, private and government response. So we're going to get into all of that. Oh, and Kamala says she owns a Glock. No one believes her. Yeah, we'll get to that too. Are you putting in the effort with exercise and mindful eating, yet feeling frustrated by the lack of results? You're not alone. Many people share your experience, but now you can get the advantage that you need for your heart health through SuperBrain, providing 2-in-1 advanced cholesterol support to help you achieve your goals. Your experience with SuperBrain will be incredible, and it'll be a convenient and very simple addition to your routine that makes a huge difference, and you're going to love your experience. The formula in SuperBrain features a clinically studied berberine, and that shows nearly 10 times higher absorption than standard berberine. Plus, the Italian olive fruit extract adds strong antioxidant properties that support cardiovascular health. Boost your cholesterol health with advanced support and get a free month supply of SuperBrine plus 15% off. Don't miss out on this great offer. Head over to superbrine.com and use promo code Dana. That's SuperBrine, BERINE.com, code Dana, for your free month of SuperBrine. Act now and feel the difference. SuperBrine.com, code Dana.
And now, all of the news you would probably miss. It's time for Dana's Quick Five.
So Geico is terminating insurance coverage of Tesla Cybertrucks, saying that this type of vehicle doesn't meet our underwriting guidelines. I just don't ever, people use Geico. Do they? You do use Geico? Do you like Geico? I was going to make fun of them.
Make fun of them. Who cares?
I want lizard insurance. It's for lizard people. Isn't that for lizard people? Are you one of them lizard people? Why don't they? So they said, no, they just at the Cybertruck, they said that they can't insure it because they think it's risky. I mean, there are riskier cars out there, but go ahead and be,
Risky or expensive? Actually, I think it's expensive.
Look, I'm gonna tell y'all something. You guys know I've been dealing with laryngitis. I'm not sick, and I've been on a massive amount of steroids. It's probably why I seem like I wanna cut people more often than not this week. I'm coming down off of them, but today is not the day to be messing, okay? Not the day. There could be a jet lag cure on the horizon. This sounds gross. I don't know what this means. A tiny protein tail? Ugh. They said that it's a small section at the end of a protein. It could just eat protein tails, right? Powdered protein tails. There you go. It's the casein kinase 1 delta. Oh, that makes total sense. It's a pacemaker for our biological clock. Blah, blah, blah. Just take a red eye and sleep. There you go. Problem solved. Anyway, they think that there could be a cure for it. Don't expect human life expectancy to grow much more, thankfully, says a researcher over at the Associated Press. Humanity is hitting the upper limit of life expectancy, according to a new study. A lot of people aren't making it to age 100 anymore because the Earth hates them. They said we have to recognize there's a limit and perhaps reassess assumptions about when people should retire and about how much money they'll need to live out their lives, says Cynthia, a University of Illinois Chicago researcher. Actually, his name's James Olshanky. He was the lead author of the study. You know what? I enjoy working. I can't stand sitting. But that's like a whole other topic. But, you know, just let, I don't know. I don't think that people need to be living to 200 because, you know, at some point, you know, people are tired of you. Go away. But, you know. Also, there's now fears of a global oil shock if the Mideast crisis intensifies. So glad that we didn't build any refineries and we didn't do anything to boost up our own potential under the Biden-Harris administration. That was some great foresight. The world absorbing the prospect of escalating conflict in the Middle East, the fallout is sowing increasing alarm. Now, I mean, this is today and obvious, this headline that could be summed it up like that. A doctor admits disguising himself as a nurse to try to kill his mother's partner with poison. This is going to be a definite interesting, like, true crime doc. A British doctor admitted that he tried to kill his mom's long-term partner who stood between him and an inheritance. He was trying to inject the man, Kane, with a poison disguised as the COVID vaccine. Prosecutors say Thomas Kwan pretended to be a community nurse delivering booster shots and injected Patrick O'Hara with a toxic substance, likely pesticide. It caused a rare and life-threatening flesh-eating disease. He initially denied attempted murder but changed his plea after prosecutors laid out their case and proved unequivocally that he was the baddie. We've got a lot more on the way, including the attempts to politicize a hurricane and North Carolina and Florida, the difference in response. And David Axelrod knows it. Stick with us. It's that time again. Students are returning to school, and I want to share a fantastic learning opportunity with you. So as part of the most informed audience on TV, you'll be pleased to know that the folks over at Hillsdale College have launched the Hillsdale College Podcast Network. This network offers top quality content that delves into education and liberty issues. You and your family can enrich your knowledge by tuning in to lectures and educational podcasts like Radio Free Hillsdale Hour, the Hillsdale College Online Courses Podcast, Imprimis and Hillsdale College K-12 Classical Education Podcast. You'll also find special content from Hillsdale's President Larry Arn. Listen together at home, while taking a walk or driving to school or work. With over 2 million downloads, the Hillsdale College Podcast Network is a great way to stay informed. You can find the Hillsdale College Podcast Network on all major podcast platforms. Explore and pick your new favorite podcast today at dana4hillsdale.com. That's dana4hillsdale.com. Well, now, there's a hair-raising, eyebrow-raising news story that just hit. I mean, it is October. Welcome back, Dana Loesch, with you. It is October. Would you guys like to hear about it? It's about wife guy second dude.
That sounds right.
Second dude.
Second dude?
Second dude. Yeah.
Second dude, yeah.
Yeah. Doug Emhoff. He's really leaning into this whole, no, I'm just the husband of the vice president. She's the more power. I think he's doing that as like a veneer to hide like his past indiscretions because, ooh, here's a headline. Quote, Doug Emhoff was a foul-mouthed A**hole and misogynist who hired a trophy secretary because she was pretty and retaliated against women who didn't flirt back at L.A. law firm. Ex-staff, plural, claim. Believe all women, right? Isn't that where we're at now? Me too. Attorneys who worked with Doug Emhoff at his former firm Venable say he yelled expletives, held a men-only cocktail hour in the office, revoked work perks from women who didn't flirt with him, and only took young, attractive associates in a limousine to a ball. I thought this was America. The lawsuit also claims sex discrimination by other partners that he ran while he was engaged to Harris. And he hired an unqualified part-time model as a legal secretary because she was friendly with the powerful men in the office, is the claim. He looks like the guy who does that. He's trying to have like his Taiki Waititi moment, and he's just not happening. He looks like the guy who would do something like that, doesn't he? Can I just say, sidebar. This is why I don't understand, like, sugar babies. The looks got to play into it. You know, money can't make that visage more attractive. I just could not. There's no way on God's green earth. There's just no way. What woman, you're going to hire a model to be a legal secretary because she's pretty and she flirts with the ugly, powerful men in the office? I mean, they're still ugly, right? Looks is power. They're still ugly. I look at him and I'm like, that's not a, ew. Just, right? I don't know. Maybe I'm the only, I don't know. I just, no, money cannot buy everything. So he's, now he acts like he's this feminist ally and a wife guy. Have you noticed that all the dudes who say that they're feminists are typically like abusive jack wagons? Have you noticed this? That all comes out. Like they all get milkshake ducked by like past posts. Do you guys know that term? I think I explained it in one of my books. It was a joke that somebody made. Oh, here's a little duck that loves drinking milkshakes. 5 seconds later, we regret to inform you that the duck is racist. So it's a milkshake duck. Like you find something in their past that you thought they were nice and you thought they were cute. It's like I'm waiting for Mu Dang to get milkshake ducked. The little pygmy hippo in Thailand, which I watch all the time, and that's all any of the algorithms show me is Mu Dang stuff. It's okay. But he looks like the guy who's, doesn't he? He has that smarmy look. Okay, another sidebar. Women, you know when you look at a chick if she's crazy. Women have a radar. Dudes, do you have a radar that is equal to that of a woman looking at a chick and saying, that woman's crazy, warning? Dudes, can you do the same thing by looking at another dude and be like, he's nuts, warning? Is that, do you have that superpower, Kane?
Well, yeah, I can. You can see it in women. I don't know how
but
women
dudes,
see it in
men. But in dudes, can you
look
at another dude and be like Doug Emhoff and be like, yeah, he looks like
a... Oh, can
like
a guy spot
Yeah, can
spot
you
that?
See it
yes.
in another guy? Yeah. Steve, can you see it in another guy?
I mean, men are better gaslighters, I think, so probably not. They kind of hide it.
Interesting.
No, you can kind of tell. There's Depends. Posturing, there's eye contact, there's breathing, all of that stuff, that body language. It's subtle, but you can tell.
Don't you think that in his interviews, Doug Emhoff tries to act like he's, again, he's like, well, I'm a wife guy. I'm just a wife guy. Right? Yeah. I mean, this is a guy who, he cheated on his first wife, impregnated his nanny. And now we've got these accusations. And it just, he slapped that girl in the line at the valet at Cannes Film Festival, which is like the bougiest thing I've ever heard. So I don't know. I mean, all of the false accusations that had no evidence against Kavanaugh were enough to almost like derail his Supreme Court advances. And Kamala Harris led that. So what about this? I just feel... Yes, I do completely believe in James, the ideology of James Brown in the big payback. Yes, I absolutely do. You are 1,000% correct. So I'm just saying, you know, it just seems like, you know, what's good for the goose is good for the gander here, Kamala. Just saying. But I don't know if, I mean, she's dealing with some bad stuff right now. Can we talk about the 60 Minutes interview? It's bad. It's so bad. They asked her if she owned a gun. And it was weird. They asked her if she owned a gun. And, well, this is what she says. This is audio soundbite 7. Listen to this.
A hard left turn here. But you recently surprised people when you said that you are a gun owner. And then if someone came into your
that
house.
That was not the first time I've talked about it. That's not the first time I've talked about it.
So what kind of gun do you own and when and why did you get it?
I have a Glock and I've had it for quite some time. Mm-hmm. And I mean, look, Bill, my background is in law enforcement.
Which means nothing.
And so there you go.
Have you ever fired it?
Yes. Of course I have. At a shooting range.
So he does. I was watching this interview. Bill Whitaker's interview style is interesting. I'm giving him credit. This is what it looks like when you do your job. He asks a question and then he just lets it sit and he doesn't do anything else. He lets it sit. And then the silence makes her nervous and she freaks out and she's got to fill the time with words. That's a great, like it's an actual technique. And he does it very well. And he looks down at his notes and then looks back up and smiles. He disengages eye contact to leave her hanging for a moment. It is the art of bodily persuasion. And then he looks up at her and she's already freaking out because he disengaged to look at his notes. And then he just purses his lips and kind of smiles at her. Very disingenuous. It's a process smile. It's not like a real smile of, you know, empathetic or emphatic feeling. It's just, it is a very interesting interview. and they're totally going to go after this guy. But because I don't think he's on the right. I think he just likes her. I think he's just done with it. Let's you know, ask some questions. But she's like, well, you know, I was in law enforcement. Like, what, you were storming houses? The hell does that mean? No one believes that Kamala Harris was out there. Yes, I was in law enforcement, so of course I have a gun. I was out there storming houses and arresting baddies. That's what I was doing. No one believes that she... I mean, in that event, I'd be like, well, it'd be a SIG, wouldn't it? Anyway, but she's like, I have a Glock. If Bill Whitaker would have said, what, Jen? What generation? She would have crumpled in on herself and fallen off the chair. Really, what, Jen? A Glock? Mm-hmm. What? So what generation, though? And just check your notes and look up. And then when he goes, have you fired it? And then he just looked at her and would not help her out. And she was incredulous. And then she's like, yeah, I fired it. At a range. Had to fill the space. She would have kept going. I think she would have kept going if he wouldn't have asked her another question. So awkward. No one believes that she's got a gun. I think that she came up with that because she partners with a gun control group that's actually suing Glock. And I think that that was like the first thing that popped into her head. And that's why she said it. Yes, I have a Glock. No, you don't. No one believes that you have a Glock. Literally nobody. Just nobody. Man, these are so bad. I don't even know what one I want to go to next. It's so bad. Tim Walz didn't do any better. He didn't really do any better. Audio soundbite 18. I mean, this Bill Whitaker just took both of these stooges to the woodshed. This is so bad.
In your debate with J.D. Vance, you said, I'm a knucklehead at times. And I think you were referring to the time that you said that you were in Hong Kong during the Tiananmen Square unrest when you were not.
Yeah.
Is that kind of misrepresentation, isn't that more than just being a knucklehead?
I think folks know who I am, and I think they know the difference between someone expressing emotion, telling a story, getting a date wrong rather than a pathological liar like Donald Trump.
But I think it comes down to the question of whether you can be trusted to tell the truth.
Yeah, well, I can. I think I can. I will own up to being a knucklehead at times, but the folks closest to me know that I keep my word.
But nobody else does, because you don't. I mean, Whitaker was not letting him go one bit. Was not letting him go. Gosh, it's really satisfying to watch. I think I'm just going to keep playing these for the rest until election day. These clips, it was bad. It was bad. And it just was so bad. It was so bad. And he sat down separately, Walz and Harris. The cuts keep coming. And in the meantime, audio soundbite 12, she can't explain her way out of anything. Whitaker goes, well, groceries are more expensive and everyone blames you. What do you say?
Groceries are 25% higher. And people are blaming you and Joe Biden for that. Are they wrong?
We now have historic low unemployment in America among all groups of people. We now have an economy that is thriving by all macroeconomic measures. And to your point, prices are still too high. And I know that, and we need to deal with it, which is why part of my plan, you mentioned groceries, part of my plan is what we must do to bring down the price of groceries.
Yeah. Well, how are you going to bring down the price of groceries? I mean, why can't you do it now? Because you're there. It's almost like, I mean, she sits here and she says, well, we're going to do this and we're going to do that. Why aren't you doing it now? You're the vice president of the United States. The hyphen counts. You're there now. Why don't you? It was bad. So she's going off of the tantrum about the hurricane. That's what she used to follow up her 60 Minutes interview, and the cuts are still coming. And then the 60 Minutes interview followed that Daddy Issues podcast. That was bad. And then now she's apparently going on with Stern. Has her stuff from The View even hit yet? Because she taped The View. Has that even hit yet?
Oh, yeah.
Did it hit?
Yeah.
I literally never watch those cronies. I just don't. Oh, there it is. Thank you. Thank you, Steve. I didn't watch it because Steve, we can count on Steve doing it. Steve getting it. So this, oh boy, audio soundbite 27. You heard that answer she just gave on groceries and all that. Remember who's in the White House, right? Remember who's in Biden-Harris. Okay, now play audio soundbite 27. This is so bad.
Well, if anything, would you have done something differently than President Biden during the past 4 years?
There is not a thing that comes to mind in terms of, and I've been a part of most of the decisions that have had impact.
So nothing. Oh, well, that's comforting. So forward the same? I wouldn't change anything. Forward. That's what I would have asked. So forward then. Yeah, nothing comes to mind. I just don't know. Don't know what I do different. Merk, 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 knucklehead. We've got a lot more on the way. We're watching everything with the hurricane, Hurricane Milton, which is expected to make landfall tomorrow. Florida is just is prepping for that. We have a lot of friends, a lot of family, and a lot of listeners in Florida. So we're keeping an eye on all of that. Of course, you know, they've got local weather and all of that down there as well. But man, everybody stay safe and please don't forget your pets. We're going to get into all of that. We got some election. We got some culture, all kinds of stuff on the way still. If you haven't had Black Rifle Coffee yet, now is the perfect time to taste why they're becoming one of the most popular coffee companies in America. Black Rifle Coffee Company is veteran founded, veteran run, and every purchase you make helps fuel their mission to support veteran and first responder causes. And that includes getting much needed equipment to first responders, helping vets fight cancer, and so much more. Black Rifle serves a wide variety of ground coffee, whole bean, K-cups, and ready-to-drink coffee for those on the go. Everything from the roast to the bag art pays homage to American culture and military history, and every bag is roasted right here in America. Black Rifle is the go-to in my house, and it keeps me going all day through every broadcast, and you can have Black Rifle Coffee as well. Make sure you visit blackriflecoffee.com, order today, and get 20% off using code Dana. Again, save 20% off using code Dana at blackriflecoffee.com.
Like sands through the hourglass, so are the days of the United States.
Guns don't protect our free speech. Our free speech is protected by the consent of the governed laid out through the Constitution. It's not based on the threat of violence. It's based on elections, organizing, referendums, a judicial system. Our social contract offers many, many avenues to remedy these issues and allows sides to be heard and adjudicated. Guns, from what I can tell, seem to mostly protect the speech of the people holding the gun. It's a tool.
He doesn't understand the difference between an enumerated right and a social compact, a social contract. Really? A social compact and an enumerated right are two entirely different things. I mean, I get that, like, some people hear these phrases and these words and they think that they can use them interchangeably and that somehow makes them sound somewhat educated, but that's not what either of those they're not interchangeable. And furthermore, if you only view firearms through the perspective of being scared of them because you have zero familiarity, then you are going to have a bias against them and you're only going to see them in one way. And to eliminate every other perspective because you think that your fear and your inexperience is supreme, well, that's un-American. And it's also dumb. And it's just not even intellectually honest. And it's incredibly illiberal. Why would you do that? So I think he's like trying to sound smart here with his commentary on that, but it's just not flying. It's not flying at all. The left is, they're apoplectic right now. I saw this headline where it said Democrats are freaking out because Kamala's joy is quietly turning to panic. Her live, laugh, love campaign has had a bit of a stumble. It has a bit of a trip, Kane. It's not doing so well. I know. Yeah, it's not doing very well. And there, I mean, I keep seeing all these people trying to defend her. Like, oh, well, you know, how dare you? Like, they're mad at me because I'm asking. I was like, if they would have asked her what generation of Glock she had, she would have not been able to answer. And they're like, well, have you prosecuted criminals, Gina? Okay, boomer. What does that have to do with knowing what kind of gun you have? You don't have, if someone's like, you know, you don't have to be an enthusiast. Relax. You don't have to be an enthusiast to understand what you own. I mean, just like you don't have to be an enthusiast of automobiles to understand what car it is that you drive. You don't have to be an enthusiast of kitchen appliances to understand what brand your dishwasher is or your stove. You just have to be aware and educated. You know, it's not as simple as going in, I'll just have the Glock. That's not, it's not like vanilla ice cream, you know? I mean, there are different models. There's different types. There's, you know, for a reason. Yeah. I'll have the Glock, please. What kind? The black Glock. I will have that. Thank you. With some of the bullets. Merci. That's Kamala Harris. I mean, I don't know. I feel like I want to make fun of that some more, and I'm going to. But the left needs to stop. Now, we've got coming up, we got some election stuff. Polls are, it's not like as ironclad as scripture. So polls are just suggestions and some guidelines and some ideas. Speculative, right? We're going to get into some of that. We got cults, we got all kinds of stuff. Stick with us, second hour on the way. As Americans, we owe immense gratitude to the brave military men and women who sacrificed their safety and lives to protect our freedom. Did you know that you can also show your support for our military veterans and first responders simply by using your cell phone with Patriot Mobile? When you switch to Patriot Mobile, you not only get reliable coverage, but you're also supporting Folds of Honor, Tunnel to Towers, Boots for Warriors, Helping a Hero, Warrior Rising, and many other worthy causes. And you can feel confident that your cell provider stands with you in defending cherished principles. Switch today and enjoy the benefits of seamless service from a 100% U.S.-based customer support team, making the switch effortless. Keep your current number and phone or upgrade. The choice is yours. Let Patriot Mobile find you the perfect plan that fits all of your preferences. Just visit patriotmobile.com/Dana or call 972-PATRIOT and get a free month of service when you use offer code Dana. So join me and make the switch today. That's patriotmobile.com/Dana or call 972-PATRIOT. Welcome back to the program. Top of the second hour, Dana Loesch here with you. You can listen coast to coast, channel 347, DirecTV, as well as Rumble, where the discussion happens. X, all kinds of good stuff. And this lot of good things. A lot of very interesting things to discuss. So I'm just wondering where the president actually had a press conference today. We've been dealing with the response to Hurricane Helene and then the preparation for Hurricane Milton. And Florida is getting ready to get just hit hard. So I hope everyone's staying safe. We're praying for everybody there. We got a lot of friends and family there, a lot of listeners there. Please don't forget your pets. And if they tell you to evac, maybe consider evacing. I know you Floridians are hardcore. Like, y'all, I know y'all. Y'all make gator jerky. I ain't even messing. I'm just saying, you know, maybe with the storm surges being anticipated at 20 feet, just stay safe. So there was a bit of a hubbub last night because DeSantis had spoken to President Biden. And I noticed that this came after Biden reportedly had spoken to DeSantis, and they both confirmed that they had the conversation. Harris had her people go to all of these press outlets and say that DeSantis ignored my call. He refused my call. Well, DeSantis was like, she never called. Or, I mean, if she called somebody's office, sure, it wasn't mine. And he had already talked to Biden. Biden tweeted out, yeah, I had a great call with DeSantis. You know, he assured, you know, they're getting everything they need. We're here to help, etc. And then he said this just a little bit ago. Listen, this is audio 731.
The governor of Florida has been cooperative. He said he's gotten all that he needs. I talked to him again yesterday, and I said, no, you're doing a great job. It's all being done well. We thank you for it. And I literally gave my personal phone number to call. So I don't know. There was a rough start in some places, but every governor from Florida to North Carolina has been fully cooperative and supportive and acknowledged what this team is doing. And they're doing an incredible job. But we got a lot more to do.
You know what it sounded like to me just then? Because Harris has spent, I'm just going through. I'm actually right now scrolling through all of my, all of the headlines that I've saved. She had her people go to at least like 16 or 17 different outlets. Okay, well, maybe that's a double count here. This is but at least 15. Whining that DeSantis ignored, refused, blew off, etc. Any of this. All of her outreach. And I'm trying to figure out where the vice president has ever historically figured into standard operating procedure in an emergency response. I mean, it's rhetorical. The answer, it's never. But she absolutely tried to make this a political stunt when it wasn't needed. If she was a smart candidate, she wouldn't have done it, first off. She's not smart, so she did it. If she was somewhat smart, she would have found a way to salvage it. So when she was asked on the tarmac, about DeSantis and did he ignore your call, she could have said, well, Governor DeSantis is preparing for a major Category 5 hurricane right on the heels of Hurricane Helene. He's got a lot on his plate. He's doing everything he can to steal his state. And we in the Biden-Harris administration are here to make sure that, you know, that Floridians get everything that they need. That would have been the smart answer for her to do, because she would have seemed generous. She would have seemed, not that she was trying to politicize it. I mean, that's like your basic answer, right? How hard is it to just do that? Right? Super simple. Not what she did, though. Audio soundbite 6. She did this instead.
Governor DeSantis, NBC is reporting Governor DeSantis is ignoring your calls on hurricanes, resources, and help. How does that hurt the situation here?
You know, moments of crisis, if nothing else, should really be the moment that anyone who calls themselves a leader says they're going to put politics aside and put the people first. People are in desperate need of support right now, and playing political games at this moment in these crisis situations, these are the height of emergency situations, is just utterly irresponsible, and it is selfish, and it is about political gamesmanship instead of doing the job that you took an oath to do, which is to put the people first.
Why that response? She was like petty and mean, completely unnecessary. She's not the president of the United States. There was no reason for her to be involved in any of it. She decided to insert herself. And then, of course, you know, that was one of the friendlies in the press that they had that came forward. And again, all she had to do was say, you know, Governor DeSantis is just, you know, he's doing everything that he can in order to prepare his state for this Category 5. It's going to make landfall near Tampa on Wednesday. And she's like, we know that there's storm. You know, he's doing everything he can. He's got, we here in the Biden-Harris administration are, and she could have inserted herself in that way. We here in the Biden, and we in the administration are here to make sure Floridians get everything that they need, et cetera, et cetera. That's all, that's what they could have done, right? And instead she did that. That is really bad political stunting. It's bad acumen to not be able to read the room. I made mention on this. I was on Fox Business last night and I talked about this. And I think let me pull this up because I also have this. I noted this piece. I think it was in your prep. The comment that David Axelrod had made. And I thought it was incredibly, I can't believe I'm saying it. It was insightful. I don't always say that about some of the pundits on the left, but it was somewhat insightful. Because he was discussing how Democrats can mess this stuff up. And that's, you have to realize, this is how Democrats look at emergencies. They look at emergencies in this regard. They look at it like, well, you know, how can we exploit this for, I'm not saying that. That was, who was it that said that? Not Eric Holder. Somebody, it was one of Obama's folks that said that. And so he had made the point that, you know, the folks that are in North Carolina, he's talking about Hurricane Helene recovery. He's like, the folks that are in that area of recovery for Hurricane Helene, you know, that are going to vote for Democrats, they're going to continue voting for Democrats. And there's, you know, not going to be that much that anybody can do. But he said, you know, there are going to be those people. I'm going to pull this up. There are going to be those people that are, you know, voting for Trump, and this is going to steal that. He said that upscale North Carolina Harris voters will find a way to vote after the storm. And he's already been blasted because he said that, you know, he's already getting a lot of heat for this because he was saying that it's could hurt voter turnout. And he also added that it's not going to be easy to wrangle Trump voters following Hurricane Helene. Now, I know that everybody be outraged about, you know, what he's being very clinical here. And North Carolina is, it's a swing state. It's a battleground state. It's a state that both Democrats and Republicans really need to win. And this is one of the reasons why the Democrat governor there, his hurricane response is absent and was a mess, and why it's so important. And I also think, too, it's one of the reasons you're not seeing a lot of press on the ground in North Carolina. And we're going to talk about that in a moment. North Carolina, Trump is barely in the lead in North Carolina. It's very close. They've been leaning Republican. They elected a Democrat governor, but they lean kind of Republican. You have less than a month away. State's voter registration deadline is October 11th. And Axelrod, these killer storms, there's a lot of displacement. And he was talking about these voters. He said, you know, liberal voters are going to figure out a way to vote. I'm not sure about, you know, the others. And he said, you know, it's going to be hard to wrangle Trump voters. So he's talking about access to vote, but he's also discussing, and he didn't dive into it, and this is what Democrats and I think some Republicans are missing. You have, in real life, playing out before you, a tale of two ideologies. Look at North Carolina. You have the Democrats who insist that the government is the only way to help, that the government can help you, the government will be able to save you, the government is going to be there if there is a storm, if there is an emergency, whatever it is, the government is going to be there to assist you. That's what we hear time and time again. And in Florida, you have the government, is the federal government was impeding disaster response. FEMA was locking up landfills to the point where DeSantis literally threatened every agency. He went down there to one of the counties where they did this and literally ripped open the fences so that people could continue to remove debris. Tons of debris have already been removed. And this is just from Helene, not even getting into Milton yet. And he came out with a thing yesterday. He got hit by the Orlando Sentinel yesterday because he came out with another affirmation, even though you can't, under the color of federal law, ban carry or possession, you know, purchase, et cetera, of firearms in a disaster. They said it was mistaken, but I think it was like Okeechobee where they tried that. The sheriff tried that. And DeSantis's administration was told, and they immediately intervened. And even though it's a right, they're doubly reaffirming it and letting everyone know in a time when people need to be their own first responders, you're not going to deny someone their Second Amendment right of self-defense. So they did that again. They've been getting things rerouted, getting things ready ahead of this Category 5 storm. And they've been working with a lot of, you know, you have a lot of private partnerships. And that's one of the things that Florida is really, really big on. They've developed in their state, they actually have a portal to where the state government works with private religious and non-religious alike, private organizations, and they find a need and they fill a need, and it's at less of a burden on the taxpayer. And it's these people that are volunteering and going out there and helping their fellow man. It's pretty unusual to see it happening, to see that. And that was something that's been implemented in the past couple of years in the state of Florida, and it was spearheaded by the First Lady. So, First Lady of Florida. And so that you have this private partnership with these private organizations and private, you know, regular average everyday citizens responding. When you compare that to what you see in North Carolina, and then when you see in North Carolina, it's not the government that's getting in there to help, it's private entities. Like I said, you are seeing a tale of two ideologies play out in real time. And that's what Axelrod is kind of intimating. He's sitting here saying, look, they're going to see this. And people are seeing the disastrous response, FEMA's response here in North Carolina and elsewhere. It's pretty bad. You know, you're going to see this play out. And people are going to vote if you think that there aren't any independents in North Carolina whose minds have been irrevocably changed going into November because of the way FEMA's responded, you're mistaken. And that's why Democrats are trying so hard to, I think, get ahead. And they were trying to politicize this a little bit, too. We're going to talk about that. We're also going to talk about the Governor Roy Cooper. He is claiming that it's misinformation to say what people are saying about the state, but it's not misinformation. I mean, this information is coming from the videos and the mouths of the people who live there and who are enduring it. And have you noticed there's not really a lot of media on the ground in North Carolina? Not the way that they sent people to Katrina or Ian or Adelia or anywhere else. Have you noticed that? There's not a lot of media on the ground. Have you seen anybody, CNN and Waiters, standing out there in waist-deep water? I wonder why. Is it because they don't want to tell you the story of what happens when you're not ready? What happens when the federal system fails because it wasted your taxpayer dollars? We're going to discuss that because there's a reason why they're not doing it. No matter why you're preparing emergency survival food, it's crucial that your supplies last as long as you need them without compromising on flavor. It doesn't have to taste awful. check out my top recommendation for the best survival food available, and that's ReadyWise Foods. Stocking up on ReadyWise emergency food means that you're set for whatever comes your way. Whether it's a natural disaster, a power outage, an unforeseen storm, having a well-prepared stash helps you tackle any challenge with assurance. Stock up with 8 servings of brown sugar maple oatmeal, 12 servings of whey milk, and 4 each of cheesy macaroni, teriyaki rice, and tortilla soup. It's perfect for groups or just a hearty solo meal. And you can enjoy real tasting meals with ReadyWise. Savor hot, comforting meals in any crisis. ReadyWise is essential gear with a 25-year shelf life, providing easy to cook, delicious meals for your survival supplies. Visit ReadyWise.com and use promo code Dana20 at checkout for 20% off any regularly priced items. That's ReadyWise.com, promo code Dana20 for 20% off. ReadyWise.com.
And now, all of the news you would probably miss. It's time for Dana's Quick Five.
So the Tampa International Airport has suspended operations and is closed ahead of Hurricane Milton. They plan to resume services as soon as it's safe to do so later this week, but passengers are told to check airlines regarding flight schedules. I mean, be in charge of your own flight stuff, because there's going to be cancellations galore and all kinds of stuff. So just be prepared. Because there's a Category 5. No one wants to be up in the air on that. I was talking to a friend of mine. In fact, she used to work on the program. Her parents just came in from Italy, and they had to rush home, get their animals, and skedaddle. But be safe out there. North Korea is they're dealing with a major food crisis. And as a result, they're facing a new wave of threats amid said food crisis. There are thefts, that's kind of, you don't really hear a lot about crime coming out of North Korea, and I think for a reason, because they probably, they kill you if you get the wrong haircut. I mean, didn't the dude feed his, uncle to dogs or something like that? The short stack down there? Yeah. All right. Well, so they said that the looting is widespread. Now, they have burglars terrorizing the neighborhood, and that they're facing a major hunger strike. Let's see. A plane train causes pandemonium at an Atlanta airport. The plane train. A computer problem with the train that shuttles passengers between concourses at Atlanta. It caused a lot of confusion yesterday. People were trying to get to their gates at the world's busiest airport. But the plane train did return to normal schedule after experiencing a computer issue. That is not an airport you want to have an issue, because it's crazy. They said that there were masses of people at a standstill in the underground concourses, which is my absolute nightmare. So they were getting that all figured out. So, good heavens. Let's see here. The Supreme Court. They've started they're back in session, the Supreme Court, and they're hearing ghost gun cases. They're hearing all about that today. Those were some of the first oral arguments before the Supreme Court today. And so we're going to follow along with that as well and bring you any updates to it. And let's see. Keith Olbermann wants Elon Musk deported. What else do we got? We also have Michigan Supreme Court says schools can keep curricula a secret from parents, which I don't think that should be allowed. That's your tax dollars. If my dollars are in there, you bet I'm going to be waist deep up in your business. That's how that all works. But they said there was a parent seeking school documents, and Michigan parents, they can't request some of the curricula under Public Records Act because the court chose to not to hear an appeal from a lower court. So they're fighting over that. And Sweden is the latest nation across the Atlantic done with open immigration, allowing people to come in totally unvetted. It's a dramatic U-turn. We got a lot more on the way. Stick with us. Are you facing tax challenges and unsure where to turn? Look no further than Tax Network USA. With a proven success record of saving clients over $1 billion in back taxes, they've established themselves as a trusted leader in tax relief. Their expert team is dedicated to finding the best resolutions for your unique tax issues, ensuring that you achieve the most favorable outcomes. Don't let the government theft agency, the IRS, catch you off guard. With October 15th as the deadline approaching, now is the time to act. And failing to file or make payments could lead to serious consequences, like wage garnishments or even property seizures. Protect yourself and get ahead of the deadline. Whether you owe $10,000 or $10 million, personal or business, they possess the tools and experience to tackle any situation. And they've assisted thousands in reducing their tax burdens. So don't miss that October 15th deadline. Visit TNUSA.com/Dana. or call 1-800-958-1000 for a free consultation. They'll guide you through a few simple questions to determine how much you can save. Act now before it's too late. TNUSA.com/Dana or call 1-800-958-1000. And make sure you sign up over at Substack, Chapter and Verse. Lots of good stuff that comes out on the reg over there. And it's just me, so not gonna be selling your information. So we've been following the latest with Hurricane Milton, historically bad hurricane. I'm looking at the tracking at it as it's barreling towards Florida, potentially catastrophic, Category 5. And Tampa Bay is bracing for the hit. They're looking at storm surges as high as 15 feet. I've heard 20. A lot of flooding inland. People are fleeing. It's going to be hitting about Thursday morning. It's going to be right off the coast Wednesday evening. Thursday morning, it's going to hit. And then it's going to traverse over Florida and then be on the other side around Thursday evening at that point. So it's going to be going right in through Tampa, passing under Orlando. And it's right off the coast. The Yucatan Peninsula right now, and just wild, wild. So everybody stay safe. Everybody stay safe out there. And this, you know, right on the heels of Hurricane Helene. It is hurricane season. This is not abnormal for something like this to happen. It's just unfortunate. I mean, that's the, you know, it's, you got, it, it's the nature of things. And nature can be deadly, as we see. One of the questions that I had, and I was actually talking with a friend of mine about this. It was like a couple of days ago. And I was just kind of looking over our messages. I remember, and you guys remember this too. It doesn't matter what, if it was Hurricane Katrina, if it was Idalia, or if it was Ian, or whatever it was. Aren't there always just tons of media on the ground and they're in waist-deep waters, especially near an election season? I mean, think about it. Think about how the media did Katrina and Ian and everything else, right? Think about the way they just try to politicize this with Milton. North Carolina. Now, I'm looking at this the way that the left does, because I have a suspicion. This is what I was talking about with my friend. North Carolina is a battleground state. It is. It's a battleground state. North Carolina is... incredibly important to, I guess, you know, Democrats, obviously Democrats and Republicans. They both got to deliver. Both these parties have to deliver. And I'm looking at the absence of coverage, like on the ground in North Carolina. Have you seen, and Kane, maybe I've missed it, but have we like somehow missed like all the reporters standing waist deep in the water in North Carolina and talking about, you know, recovery? Or because they keep saying that there's all this fake news coming out of North Carolina, but it's from the citizens' own videos. Where are the reporters there?
It's a great question, because I haven't seen anything from the mainstream media.
I mean, they're always there, especially if they could get there and try to say, oh, look at the right that's making up these pieces or making up these, you know, all of this stuff about Hurricane, you know, Helene and the recovery efforts and all this fake news. Aren't they so mean, et cetera, et cetera. I mean, I would just think that, you know, I don't know. I'm kind of amazed that there's like an absence of this. And this is what I was talking with my friend about. I mean, you know that there would be, if there's fake news, media would be on the ground showing it, right? If the devastation wasn't as bad, they'd be on the ground showing it. If they, like all of this stuff, because they were saying that it was false to allege that FEMA was stopping anyone from delivering anything. They tried to say that the videos that people who have been displaced that they took with their own phones are somehow fake news or disinformation. They were arguing that, you know, being broke and not having enough money to help North Carolina, that's a lie, even though that was true. I mean, they keep saying that it's all conspiracy theory. Okay, well, where are they at with their news crews on the ground? My friend had written, well, it's an election year and our reporting might show that stranded locals might be telling the truth and now spreading misinformation. Democracy itself is at stake. Can't take the risk. Sorry about your house, though. For real, though, if they wanted to show that all the misinformation, that everything that was coming out of North Carolina was misinformation, wouldn't they do it? Wouldn't they show it? And then you've got the Democrat governor, Roy Cooper, who's bending into this. Audio soundbite 16. Listen.
And you're also making some people wary of applying for aid and relief, because you have these crazy stories about FEMA coming in and taking people's land and stopping donations from coming in. And it's very frustrating when you're on the ground working hard every day. In fact, I'm going to leave here, go to the Emergency Operations Center, and head back out west again. But I'll tell you what, the people of Western North Carolina are resilient and determined and courageous, and we're going to be with them every step of the way.
Did you see how he did that, though? Well, you know, it's scaring people from getting help. I don't think anybody's been dissuaded from getting help by talking about what accurately is happening there. I mean, they keep saying that the firsthand accounts of what people are experiencing in North Carolina are somehow disinformation. Then prove it. If they wanted to do it, they would be out there with all their camera crews and their everything, and they would do it immediately. Now, I do think that there's exaggeration and there's probably some falsehoods for sure. But that's like the exception, not the rule. I mean, I agree that there is a reason why you have not seen all the alphabet news agencies out there like they would be with Katrina or anything else. This is a battleground state. Trump is like, what, 0.6 ahead? They have to be very careful with this, because if you think about it, this could determine the election. North Carolina. I know everyone's talking about Pennsylvania, but look what's happening in North Carolina. Sure, they got a Democrat governor, but they've been leaning red. And then now look at what's happened with the hurricane response. And then now they're being told that the things that they're sharing, that they've seen themselves and filmed with their own phones and have sent and uploaded to the internet, that's like disinformation. You're calling these people liars as they're suffering. That's bad. This is one of those things where you could actually see it affect the election to that degree. And so there's a reason why they're not, I think, showcasing it that way. They're not down there on the ground. Mm-mm-mm. Now, audio soundbite 14, one of the members of the Biden administration is criticizing the people, it's FEMA administrator, criticizing the people criticizing FEMA. This is too rich. Listen.
But I want to make sure that this has to stop, because if it continues, we will see more and more people not trusting their federal government to be able to give them what they need. And so I need people to register for assistance so I can get them the financial resources they need to support their recovery.
Well, it's leading to people criticizing the people who are criticizing FEMA's bad response isn't the way to go. That doesn't make any sense. You should be able to hold these agencies accountable. Absolutely. A few other things, because, you know, obviously we're following this. I want to make sure that we're touching on everything else as well, although mainly it's all election and hurricane today, understandably so. I wanted to pull this up. This was an exclusive piece over at Red State from Jennifer Van Laar, who's been on the show before. 40 U.S. soldiers were stranded in Israel on October 7th, which we just had the observance of yesterday, 1 year. Hamas knew their names, ranks, and locations. What? 40. They were in Israel as an advance team for what was a routine training exercise. And that was last year, October 7th. They suddenly found themselves, obviously, in the middle of a terror attack. And they had to beg reluctant Pentagon officials, Van Laar reports, to send an Air Force plane to extract them. Approximately a quarter of the soldiers were just miles from Gaza in off-base housing near the IDF's base there when the attack began. A group of local Israelis, IDF reservists, police officers, and ordinary citizens got them to the base, which Hamas terrorists were quickly heading towards. And then the team leader, because he saw his men were in mortal danger, requested permission to open the arms locker so they could retrieve their arms. But it was denied at CENTCOM level. CENTCOM denied them. What? Ask again why recruitment is down. You have people who are pushing pencils across the ocean saying, no, you can't defend yourself from a terrorist attack. Oh, and if you try, we'll court-martial you and we'll put you in jail for the rest of your life and your life's over. Ask me again why. Ask anybody why recruitment's down. CENTCOM denied it, according to apparently one whistleblower and a military intelligence analyst. The rest of the soldiers had just arrived in Tel Aviv where rockets were hitting their hotels. They said that there was a lot of stuff going on, all kinds of indirect fire. for a good 6-8 hours. The soldiers who were there at that IDF base were in mortal danger, and the military and civilian leadership at the Pentagon were perfectly willing to not even worry about it, end quote. Hamas had fired a barrage of rockets at the airport shortly after they had one. They had one Air Force C-17 briefly touched down to exfiltrate the soldiers, and Hamas fired about 150 rockets at it. They would have been taken hostage by Hamas if it had not been for Israeli civilians and reservists. They would have been. They were unarmed. Our soldiers unarmed. CENTCOM denied them access to weapons, and they would have been taken. They would have been taken hostage. This would have been worse than Benghazi. And I can't even imagine. Can you? What would have happened? Hamas would have gotten American soldiers. Can you imagine the PR stunt they would have pulled with that? This would have been like dragging people through what, Fallujah? Oh my gosh. They said that it was a harrowing and disturbing story. They're not naming all of the sources because they fear retaliation, which you absolutely do have to worry about that, especially within the military ranks. I mean, there's a reason why they've been going after a lot of the special forces guys. They said that the U.S. Army advance team was in Israel to prepare for the 2-week live fire joint training exercise named Operation Iron Bison. And it was scheduled to kick off the third week in October at the IDF's Urban Warfare Training Center. It was southwest of Beersheba. 400 soldiers, infantry, armor, and aviation. They were deployed to Kuwait in support of Operation Spartan Shield. They were slated to participate. And they said a few weeks before October 7th, they had a group of about 10 U.S. Army logisticians that arrived. They were going to get work. They were staying off base in Beersheba. They said that they had, you know, the advanced team, and it was just training. Like, they weren't there even, you know, they weren't hiding. They were just there for their training. And they said the soldiers had their service weapons with them in Israel, but they had to be secure in an arms locker on base until the time of exercise, used for the exercise and put back. And when everything went sideways, they had requested of CENTCOM, and it was CENTCOM level, said more than two sources. CENTCOM level said no. Do you think that they look back on it now and are like, wow, October 7th, these soldiers would have been taken if it hadn't been for these reservists and citizens? Unbelievable. All of this stuff, it's a year later and we're just now learning this. Isn't that insane? Thanks for watching The Dana Show. Make sure to like, subscribe, ring the bell, and stay tuned for more content.